no-fly zone, will there be a, being a subject for negotiation? Domestically, perhaps issues like union rights in America. And it can come down to even very mundane issues, like even in the household, deciding who holds the remote control and decides on the TV. This morning, we are really privileged to have the Ford Professor of Urban and Environmental Planning at MIT, Professor Lauren Susskind. He's taught at MIT for 40 years, and is also the Vice Chair of the Program on Negotiation at Harvard Law School. He specializes in public dispute mediation. In fact, he's one of the pioneers in this area, as well as consensus building. He's well published in both popular as well as scientific literature, producing books which are readable by ordinary people, as well as formal scientific publications. But he's not just an academic, and in fact, he's the founder of a consensus building institute where he does more applied work. There are a few interesting things about the work that he's done, which I just want to flag up. He's involved in global environmental research, disputes and negotiation. For example, in leading brainstorming sessions prior to the Kyoto Protocol discussions. He's also done land disputes among Bedouin people in Israel. And more interestingly, which is something which I thought was, I just learned about a week ago, is he's been involved in creating peer negotiators, training them up among middle school children, which I thought is quite an interesting thing. Join me together in welcoming Professor Susskind.
Thanks very much. It's exciting to be here with you. I have great ambitions for you for this few hours. I hope everybody's up to it, especially since you're mostly on vacation. When I first heard about the exercise that you'll all be part of, I just made an assumption that as part of preparing everybody, there would be some kind of briefing with regard to, if not training session, with regard to negotiation. Because, from my standpoint, every effort to get anyone to do what you want, when you want them to do it, the way you want them to do it, is negotiation. Not just the things that happen formally around the table when the result is a contract, or not just diplomatic interaction, but inside organizations, between organizations, every effort to get anyone to do what you want, when you want, the way you want, as far as I'm concerned, better to know negotiation skills than not. And it turns out that over the past 25, 30 years, there's been serious scholarship on the subject of negotiation. Prior to 1980, not so much. Just people recounting their personal stories or successes, more memoirs. I'm a great negotiator, here's what I tell you to do, do this negotiation. But since 1981, when we founded the Harvard-MIT Tufts Joint Center for the Study of Negotiation, called the Program on Negotiation, we've had faculty from the three universities, from 40 faculty from the three universities, from dozens of different schools and departments, including the schools and departments that you're from, who've participated in this theory building effort. So some of the things I'm going to talk about are the product of that theory building effort. Now, for myself, unless the theory is useful in practice, who cares? And my colleagues at MIT tend to get all excited about the latest theoretical whatever. I'm not the least bit interested unless you can tell me it's going to help somebody do something more effectively somewhere. But then, of course, when someone goes off to do something, we need to monitor or track it or at least reflect on it so that we can add that back in to strengthen the theory and to improve the practice as everything moves forward. So I'm interested in giving you some very simple theoretical constructs that you can lean on both in preparing for and in carrying out the assignment that you'll be part of. I'm also interested in giving you that framework so you can reflect after the fact. You do have the third day. I would hope part of the third day you'd spend, at least for yourself, reflecting on how well did we handle negotiations both internally within the coalition that we were part of and externally in terms of the other national, international actors we had to deal with. My goal is to get you to be self-conscious about your theory of practice. That's my goal, get you to be self-conscious about your theory of negotiation practice. So I have a couple of things that I had in mind, and we'll start on those, but if your questions or interests take us in a different way, that would be fine. I'm going to hand you out everything important in the 100 books produced by the Program on Negotiation on one side of one page. And don't tell my colleagues, because they'll think I don't want you to buy their books. But I really do think I can offer you a process model of negotiation on one side of one page that will give you a way to name some things and to think about the negotiations you're stepping into. And then I'll try to talk through that process framework for about 45 minutes or so it takes me to talk through it, make sure you understand the concepts and see their relevance to what you're doing. And then I have an exercise which will allow you to see how different it is to think about and read about negotiation and then to actually do it. And in this very short mock negotiation that I will put you into, we'll see how different trios handle exactly the same assignment in real time as if we had alternative universes in which the same thing was happening but unfolding differently in real time. And maybe, I don't know, maybe this meets the test of dramatic immersion, or maybe it doesn't. I'm not sure what that term fully includes in and includes out. But I will ask you to be part of this short negotiation, and then we can debrief the results of that. And then after lunch, with all that swimming around in your head, what I want to do is be your consultant for whatever questions you have about the game coming up. But as you ask me questions about what you see that you might have to do, I'll try to link my answers to the framework and the experience of the exercise that you did. So once again, you'll see I'm trying to be helpful about the things you're worried about, but what I want you to see is this framework is going to be useful to you, not just for this exercise, but beyond. And as happenstance would have it, it is always true in my life, I presume yours as well, after the connection got made to what you guys were doing, the CDC shows up on my doorstep, completely uninvited, and says, we have this problem. We give out $2.5 billion a year to these countries to address issues of HIV/AIDS. And the problem is that we, the CDC, located in each of these countries, have pressure on us from the ministries of health, from the American ambassador's office, and mostly from AID, all of whom have other plans than what we think is necessary for how the money that's guaranteed to be going to each of these countries should actually be allocated. And we, CDC, have a results-oriented approach looking at what happened last year and talking about programs in light of what will be most effective. And those people from AID, they seem to be more worried about politics. And we have to reach agreement on how these monies are going to be spent. So we, the CDC folks from 16 countries and headquarters staff, we would like to learn to negotiate better. So could you please help us? So my staff's been interviewing these folks all around the world for the last 2 weeks, which keeps getting confused with my effort to read your case about Malawi. Not the least of which my wife works for Partners in Health and was just in the Malawi office 2 weeks ago. So my head is completely mixed up with all the stuff you're doing. So I'll try to keep that all straight as we move forward. So let me hand out this miraculous one side of one page summary of everything you need to know about negotiation. Maybe someone can help me put the right thing up on here. Okay. Okay. So, what this card tells you is that every negotiation goes through stages. There's the part before you ever sit down with the people you're negotiating with. The part where you're preparing either by yourself or with your team or with your organization. Then, there's the part where you go to the table, if you will, allow me a metaphorical table. And there's the things that happen at the beginning when you're at the table, which I will argue offer an opportunity to create value. We talk about expand the pie before you move to the third stage, which is divvying up the value you've created or deciding who gets what. Most people tend to think of negotiation as merely that third step, but that's a terrible mistake. Because how you prepare for the negotiation and what you do when you first sit down and have an opportunity to create value has a lot to do with who gets what in the third stage. I mean, you might get a big piece of the pie, but if the pie was way smaller than it needed to be, shame on you. And you're not done when you shake hands or sign a contract. Most people think negotiation ends at the third stage, but you're not done, because in real life, you will discover, if you haven't already, that the deal isn't done until everybody does what they promised. And between the time someone signs something and the time they delivered on what they promised, surprises will happen. Market conditions will change, and they would like to reopen the deal. People on their side will change. They never heard of you when you called to find out why the delivery didn't happen. New information will emerge that will cause both of you to want to adjust the terms of the deal. And many other kinds of things. And so, depending on how robust your agreement is, it either will or won't withstand the problems of follow-through. And given that we can anticipate some kinds of things that might happen during follow-through, we can fold those back on the third stage and help you get the biggest piece of the pie without ruining the relationship. Because it is the relationship that you're going to appeal to in that fourth phase. When things change, things go wrong, you want to talk about it again. If you put one over on them in order to get them to sign a really wonderful contract from your standpoint, but terrible for them, they will have realized it by the time you show up saying you'd like to amend the agreement. And the only thing on their mind will be revenge. And so you need to learn how, in the third phase, claim a big share of the value without ruining the relationship so that you can anticipate the problems of follow-through. So that's what those four slices, those four phases mean. Mm-hmm. There's what happens before you sit down. There are two things in the middle, the beginning and the end of what happens when you're face-to-face, and then there's the last column, which happens when you think you're done, but you're not really done. And you're negotiating through all four of those, and knowing what you're doing and why you're doing it is really important. If you think negotiation will take care of itself, you are very lucky.